దూరవిద్య విధానంలో డాక్టర్ బిఆర్ అంబేద్కర్ ఓపెన్ యూనివర్సిటీ దేశంలోనే మొట్టమొదటి సార్వత్రిక విశ్వవిద్యాలయం. దాదాపు 2.5 దశాబ్దాలుగా దూరవిద్య విధానం ద్వారా కంప్యూటర్ కోర్సును అనుసంధానం చేస్తూ బిఏ, బీకాం, బీఎస్సీ డిగ్రీ కోర్సులను అందిస్తోంది. పోస్ట్ గ్రాడ్యుయేషన్ స్థాయి, డిగ్రీ, డిప్లొమా స్థాయి కోర్సులను ఔత్సాహికులైన విద్యార్థులకు అందిస్తోంది. డాక్టర్ బిఆర్ అంబేద్కర్ సార్వత్రిక విశ్వవిద్యాలయం స్థానికంగా స్వయం బోధన పద్ధతిలో ముద్రణ రూపంలో రూపొందించిన కోర్స్ మెటీరియల్ అందిస్తోంది. కోర్స్ మెటీరియల్ అధ్యయనానికి సహకరించే విధంగా రేడియో, టెలివిజన్ పాఠ్యాంశాల ఆధారంగా కార్యక్రమాలు ప్రసారం చేస్తోంది. అధ్యయన కేంద్రాల ద్వారా ఏర్పాటు చేసే సలహా సంసర్గ తరగతులు, సైన్స్ ప్రాక్టికల్ సౌకర్యాలు విద్యార్థులకు స్వయం అధ్యయనానికి ఒక చక్కటి అవకాశం. ఇవి విద్యార్థి సమీపంలో ఉండే అధ్యయన కేంద్రం నుంచే పొందొచ్చు.
Hello and welcome to this discussion, the live teleconferencing of Dr. B.R. Ambedkar Open University. My name is Dr. Rabindranath Solomon, Assistant Professor, Department of Commerce, Dr. B.R. Ambedkar Open University. The topic for today's discussion is incorporation of companies under the Companies Act 2013. Before the Companies Act 2013 came into being, the 1956 Companies Act was in need of a substantial revamp because of the contingencies which were not existing when it was first formulated. There was a need to make it more contemporary to the corporate world, to the regulators, and also to the other stakeholders. A major step in this direction was the formulation of the Companies Bill 2009. Now, this Companies Bill 2009 was subsequently dropped because of the introduction of the Companies Bill 2011. The Companies Bill 2011 was discussed at length by the Parliamentary Standing Committee on Finance, and it was finally passed on 26th June 2012. Subsequently, it was sent to the Lok Sabha, and the Lok Sabha approved it on 18th December 2012. Subsequently, when it was sent to Rajya Sabha, the Rajya Sabha approved the bill on 8th of August 2013. It was sent to the President for its approval, and the approval came on 29th August 2013 when it became the Companies Act 2013. To discuss the far-reaching complications and the implications of the Companies Act 2013, we have with us in our studio today Dr. G. Swarupa, Associate Professor, Department of Commerce, and Sri Srinivas Rao, Director, Sri Harita Institute of Professional Studies, Hyderabad. This is a live teleconferencing program, and we need interaction from the audiences. So kindly follow the discussion for the first half an hour and call us on the telephone numbers flashing on your screen. I'll repeat the numbers for you: 040-2703-1431, 2703-1432, 2703-1433. Kindly follow the discussion for the first half an hour and then ask questions which are pertinent to you and also which are helpful to the audiences going through this program. Now we'll ask Dr. Swarupa. Now, we are, as you know, this topic is about the incorporation of companies under the Companies Act. Ma'am, tell us about the extent of coverage of this act.
Yes. As Dr. Rabindranath has said about the origin of this Companies Act of 2013, this is a very extensive act which applies geographically to the entire country, and in terms of provision also, it is very elaborate. It applies to many or most of the companies that operate in India. So we can say that the act applies to the whole of the country, and the provisions also apply to all companies. Say for example, companies which are incorporated under the Companies Act of 2013, as well as those companies which are incorporated under the earlier acts. And it also applies to insurance companies, which are actually governed by Insurance Act of 1938 and IRDA Act of 1999. But to the extent that the provisions are inconsistent, the Companies Act provisions will apply to insurance companies. In a very similar fashion, you find that the Act applies even to banking companies. You know, banking companies are governed by Banking Law and Act of 1949. Now, wherever there is inconsistency, the Companies Act provisions will apply even for banking companies. Same applies to power generation companies and power distribution companies, which are actually governed by Electricity Act of 2003. But again, the Companies Act provisions will apply to the electricity companies wherever the provisions are inconsistent. And you also find that there are companies which are established under special acts. Now, these companies also will be governed by Companies Act wherever there is inconsistency in the provisions of these two acts. You also find that central government has the power to notify that the provisions of the Companies Act will apply to certain companies in full or in part or with certain modifications to these entities as well. So you find that the Companies Act is very powerful, very extensive. It covers almost all the body corporates registered in India.
Okay, ma'am. As you were saying, the Companies Act covers all the companies. If there is a banking company, it is governed by the Banking Company Act. But then if there is any inconsistency,
yes,
the Companies Act will
prevail
because this is right. More supreme.
Yes.
Srinivas sir, now we are talking about incorporation. So please tell us, what is the meaning of incorporation?
Incorporation of a company is nothing but the process of the company formation. What are the different steps involved in the formation of a company? First one is promotion. Second stage is registration of company. Third one is commencement of business of company. According to Companies Act 2013, Section 11, that is commencement of the business of the company, is removed. Today, any company, whether a private company or public company, after its incorporation, it can go for commencement of its operations. So basically, there are three stages involved: promotion, registration of the company, and third one is certificate of commencement of business. Of course, today it is got removed. We can say there are two important stages in the incorporation of a company.
Okay. So dear students, you have seen that incorporation exactly means that it is a three-step process which begins with promotion and then the registration. The third step, that is the certificate of commencement of business, has been relegated to the back in the Companies Act 2013. So promotion is the first step towards the company incorporation. So we have seen what is incorporation. Now Dr. Swarupa Garu, please tell us about this promotion.
Yes. Now, the companies under the Companies Act, the way how they can be formed differs from company to company. You know, you have public limited companies, private limited companies and such other. Now, according to the Section 12 of the Companies Act, seven signatories to the Memorandum of Association, that means seven people who have signed the Memorandum of Association, can start a company. In case of a private company, even two people who sign the Memorandum of Association of a company, the company can be formed. Now, actually, a new provision has come in the Companies Act of 2013, which is called as a one-person company. Now, according to that, even one person signing the Memorandum of Association can form the company. Now, for forming the company, once they sign the Memorandum of Association, a number of documents have to be filed with the Registrar of Companies. The Registrar of Companies will verify the documents, record the documents, and also preserve the documents for inspection. Now, any document which is furnished to the Registrar of Companies become a public document and can be viewed by the public. So you find that Registrar of Companies plays a very, very important role in the formation of the company. And since you have asked what is the promotion?
Yeah, promotion.
You want it? Promotion of the company, in fact, can be taken as a process wherein a person conceives an idea and would like to start it as a project. Or as a project, that means you want to execute it. So, the promotion of a company can be defined as a process by which an idea which has been conceived is converted into a project and necessary action is taken by promoting a company to achieve the objectives for which it has been promoted.
Okay.
Whereas, a promoter is actually a person who has the idea and takes up all the necessary action to float the company and to achieve the objectives.
Okay.
So, you have the promoter, you have the process which is been carried out and the result is a company.
Formation of a
yes.
company. Okay. So, as ma'am was putting it across to us, previously any seven persons can come together and form a company. This was as per the Companies Act 1956 also. But the Companies Act 2013 has come out with a new stipulation saying that even a single person can come forward and form a company. So, they are called as single person companies or one man companies also. So, they are allowed as per the Companies Act 2013. And promotion is the process of initiating the formation of a company. Now, Srinivas sir, madam was telling us about the process and the person who starts the process is called as the promoter. Tell us about the promoter, sir.
According to Section 2, Subsection 69 of the Companies Act 2013, they gave the definition for the promoter. Promoter is one whose name appears in the prospectus or in the annual returns filed with the ROC, Registrar of Companies, under Section 92 of the Company Law. Or the Board of Directors of a company are accustomed to act as per the directions given by one person. Or the Board of Directors of a company are working as per the advice given by the professionals. In the professional capacity means excluding a chartered accountant, cost accountant, company secretary, advocate. The Board of Directors will take a professional advice from the respective persons. They were not the professionals. So, in a nutshell, promoter means whose name appears in the prospectus or in the annual returns. We identify his name in the annual returns. Or the Board of Directors of a company were accustomed to act as per the directions given by the maybe a director or a shareholder or otherwise. Otherwise, any person who is having a control over the activities of the directors as a professional advice. Here the professional advice exception is the professionals like HR accountant, cost accountant, company secretary, advocate may give advice to Board of Director. They were acting accordingly, but they were not called as a promoters. Then who can be a promoter? Promoter may be either natural person or artificial person. Like you and me, we can promote a company. Or can a company promote another company? Yes. Promoter is the first person who comes out with a business idea, gather the minimum subscribers, in case of a public company, 7 members, in case of a private company, 2 members. In case of course, OPC, one person company, only one person. Then he has to educate these people. This is the tomorrow's most promising business. And prepare the important documents like a memorandum of association, articles of association. Filing the documents with the ROC, literally he is called creator of a company. We can say no promoter, no company. Promoter plays a very important role in the formation of a company. So, we can say either natural person or artificial person can act as a promoter. Yes.
Okay. So, going by what Srinivas sir was saying, ma'am, a promoter is a person who initiates the process.
Yes.
Now, while telling us about the promoter, sir, you were also saying that a director also can act as a promoter.
Right.
Now, ma'am, a director will come into existence after the company has come into existence. Now, how can this director also become a promoter? So, is the director also a promoter, ma'am?
No, actually, according to the Company Act, the directors, employees or other officers of the company will also be considered as promoters if they have sufficient control over the company, either directly or indirectly. Now, here the word control is very important. The word control is defined under section 227 of the Act as someone who has a control over the affairs of the company, who has the right to appoint majority directors, who take control of the management, who can control the policy decisions in the company. If these people, either the directors, employees or officers of the company, can be established as having a controlling power over the company, in that capacity they can be treated as promoters of the company. But it is only an exception. Otherwise, if they only act in their professional capacity, they cannot be treated as promoters of the company. Now, why one should be treated as a promoter or not necessarily arises when there is any conflict, when you want to put some liability on a person for something that is done in the company. So it has to be established that they have acted as promoters by exercising this kind of a control. Only then they can be treated as promoters, and otherwise they are just merely the directors, employees or officers of the company.
So, a person who is acting in his professional capacity is may not be called as a promoter except in exceptional cases, as Srinivas sir, you were putting it across a short while ago. Now, in this kind of a situation or a scenario, what is the legal position of the promoter?
The exact legal position of the director, the promoter of a company, we can say, neither an agent nor the trustee. Promoter is neither an agent nor a trustee. But what is the relationship between the promoter and the company? You could say fiduciary relationship, nothing but a trust and confidence. There is the trust and confidence, that is fiduciary relationship between the promoter and the company. Promoter is the first person who thinks about a company, who does all the preliminary work for the formation of a company, who prepares important documents, who signs all contracts before incorporation of a company. Company believe him that he will not take undue advantage of his position. He will not make any secret profits at the cost of company's expense. In case if he make any secret profits, company can compel the promoter that he must return it to the company. Second thing, if he defrauds the company, then promoter can be removed from office. Second, that amount can be recovered from the promoter's estate in case death of the promoter, liability continues. By with the intention to defraud the creditors or investors, if company is incorporated, the registration of the company will be cancelled and the promoter will be removed from the office. Even the ROC may order for winding up of a company. It is a serious and a allegation against a promoter. So, promoter plays a vital role. That's a trust and confidence before incorporation of a company. No company. Company believing you that you will act with utmost good faith. Any agreement, any benefits are there, it must be transferred to company. He must not make any undue advantage by using his position, because he plays in a fiduciary relationship. Neither an agent nor a trustee.
Okay.
Because before incorporation there is no company. Obviously is company believing him that he will promote me, he will incorporate me, he will see to that I get a physical existence. So he plays an important role, but don't take an advantage as a promoter.
Okay.
That's an important role, is the fiduciary relationship in relation to company, we can say.
Okay. So dear students, up till now we have seen what is the meaning of incorporation, and the first step in the process of incorporation is called as the promotion of a company. The person undertakes the process of promotion is called as the promoter. The promoter is a person who can be a natural person or an artificial person who enjoys a fiduciary relationship with the company. The meaning of fiduciary relationship is a relationship of trust and confidence. The company, when it is coming into existence, will trust the promoter that he promotes the company not at the expense of the company but for the benefit of the company. So this was up till the process of promotion of a company. Now Swarupa ma'am, now here is a promoter who has come up with the process of promotion and an idea has been ignited, it has been generated. Now this company should have a name because it is a new creation. in future he cannot identify himself with the promoter or anything. There should be a distinct identity for a company. So tell us something about the name of the company, ma'am.
Yes. Now, under the Companies Act, the very definition of company says it is a legal entity, though artificial, has a separate existence of its own. It also follows that the company must have a name of its own.
Yeah.
The promoters who undertake all the necessary steps for forming a company will also have to name the company. Now, a memorandum of association is a main charter of the company, which has important clauses. And the first and very important clause is a name clause. Mm-hmm. That is where the promoters have to give the name of the company in the memorandum of association. But naming has to be done very carefully and according to the provisions of the Companies Act. Section 4 of the Companies Act deal with various provisions relating to naming of the company. Now, a name which is already there, which is the name of another existing company, or which closely resembles an existing company, cannot be accepted or taken up by a new company. This is what you call as undesirable. The central government will declare that it is undesirable to accept such kind of a name. So the promoters have to be very, very careful when they are choosing the name of the company. A good number of provisions are there in the Companies Act, which govern as well as guide the promoters in selecting a name for the company. If these provisions are not properly followed by the promoters, it is an offense. Therefore, the promoters have to be very, very careful here. And there are certain restrictions here. Say, for example, while naming the company, the promoters should not be using any word or expression which indicates that the company is related to the government, central government, state government, or a local authority, or has a patronage with any of these governmental agencies. That is totally unacceptable. You will also find that, you know, if a company wants to select a name for the new company, it is always good for the company to propose the name to the registrar of companies, which is called as reserving the name for the company. So in the due format, with paying the required fee, the promoters will apply to the registrar of companies for reservation of the name for the company. Once it is registered by the registrar of companies, it is there reserved for the company for a period of 60 days. Now, once the name is decided by the company, they should also see that the other relevant provisions, like you have the Emblems and Names Enforcement Act, which actually means to see that these emblems and names are not misused. Say, for example, when a company is choosing the name, it cannot take up something like the national flag or Ashok Chakra. These cannot be used by a company as part of its name. So if those precautions have to be taken care by the promoters, as well as you also have Companies Incorporation Rules 2014, which also are very, very important in this context. So the company has to see that the name selected is acceptable both by the registrar of companies as well as by the central government, and should be within the purview of the Companies Act of 2013. The very purpose of these rules and regulation is that to see that the general public or all those who interact with the company are not confused, are not misled, thinking that this is the agency of another company or it is same as the other company. So independent name, separate from others, which distinguishes the company, is very, very important.
Okay. Well, thank you very much, ma'am. That was a beautiful explanation about the name of the company. Srinivas sir, ma'am was saying that the memorandum of association is a document that contains the name of the company. So this document seems to be a very important document, sir. So tell us about this memorandum of association.
In the incorporation process, the second stage is registration of the company. In the registration process, there are two important documents to be filed with ROC. One is memorandum of association, other one is articles of association. A memorandum of association is a fundamental document. It is a charter of the company. It regulates company versus outside world, how company should deal with outside people. A memorandum of association must be in writing. In order to prepare the memorandum of association, under Companies Act 2013, they prescribed table A, B, C, D, E. There are five tables that are given. According to liability and shareholder share capital of a company, any one of the table can be adopted, just we have to fill the particulars and file with ROC. Important thing is today, incorporation of a company is a paperless incorporation. You need not submit a single paper to ROC. Just you have to go to the MCA website, www.mca.gov.in. Just you have to download the documents, just upload to ROC. So you have to select this any one of the tables of the table A, B, C, D, E with a view to prepare your memorandum of association. For example, a company having a share capital, shareholders liability limited by share, then follow table A. Unlimited company, follow table E. Like these conditions are there. You have to adopt any one of the table. In the memorandum of association, we have some important clauses like name clause, registered office clause, or situation clause, or domicile clause. Third one is liability clause. Fourth one is capital clause. Next one, objective clause. Next, association clause. And last one is succession clause. This is applicable only for OPC, one person company. In case of a name clause, madam already mentioned what are important things. In a nutshell, name clause. First, I have to download INC1, incorporation document 1 from MCA website. I have to select maximum 6 names, because my proposing company's name must not be too similar to another existing company. In case of a private company, the word private should be used at the end of the private limited company. And other one is, in case of undesirable names in the opinion of the central government, should be avoided. Government of India gave the list of the words, you need not use, you should not use that. On the other hand, as per the emblems and names, the prevention of the improper use act 1950, guidelines were there. You have to use, some of the norms were prohibited. Without permission from government, you can't use. Like UNO, WHO, UNICEF, pictorial representation of Mahatma Gandhi. Remember friends, the privilege was given to Mahatma Gandhi only, not others. National flag, national song, national anthem, national bird. Like this 54 words were identified. Any one of these words, if you want to use, take a permission from Government of India. Otherwise, you are not permitted. Take all these precautions and pay 1000 rupees fees to ROC. Online payment, debit card, credit cards are there. Pay the fees. From the date of the name is reserved, within the 60 days, that company should get a certificate of incorporation from ROC. Otherwise, registration will be automatically. The reservation of the name will be automatically cancelled. So this is about name. Why the name so important means, by looking at name, you are able to understand what is the name of a company, what is the objective of a company, whether this is a private company or a public company, and finally, what is the liability of the shareholder, limited liability or unlimited liability. These are indicators. For example, you take any company's name. First, you can see the company name. India Cements Company Limited. India is the name. Cement business. And company, there is no word private, which means public company. Word limited is there, which means shareholders' liability is limited. So just observe the names carefully. If the word limited is there, shareholders' liability is limited. The word limited is not there, shareholders' liability is unlimited liability. So these are the precautions have to be taken while preparing the name clause. And second one is registered office clause. What is the importance of the registered office? All meetings of the company should be held within the premises of the registered office, or at least within the PIN code where the registered office is situated. All books of accounts of the company should be preserved and maintained at a registered office. As per company law, as we know, 8 years books of accounts we have to preserve and maintain. And third one is for communication correspondence purpose. there should be registered office. Here one small clarification is there. Without a registered office, a company may get certificate of incorporation from ROC by communicating corresponding address to ROC. From the date of incorporation, within the 15 days, company will inform to the ROC and ENC 22, they have to file where the registered office is situated. From the date of incorporation, within the 30 days, verification of the registered office will be done by ROC. If the information was not communicated to the company within the 15 days, the registration can be cancelled. So, registered office is most important in order to communicate, keep the books of accounts as well as the communication purpose. And if without register office, if you incorporate, you have to communicate to ROC what is the corresponding address. This is about registered office. And third point is we have liability clause. What is the liability of the shareholders? As we know, in case of a partnership, partner's liability is unlimited. Not only his capital, but also his private estate is liable to pay liability of partnership. Whereas in case of a company, the shareholder's liability is limited. It may be limited by share, limited by guarantee. What is limited by share? The shareholder is required to pay unpaid balance on the shares held by him. And limited by guarantee means amount of guarantee given over the assets of a company in the event of winding up of a company. Here only clarification is, there are two types of companies, company with capital, company without capital. Company with capital, shareholders liability limited by guarantee, assume. That time two folds liability lies on shareholder. First is unpaid balance on the shares held by him. And the second fold is, in the event of winding up of a company, the amount of guarantee given, both you need to pay. On the other hand, company without capital, then shareholders' liability is limited to the extent of amount of guarantee given over the assets of a company. So, what is the liability of shareholder? In the liability clause, company need to define. Now, according to Companies Act 2013, the shareholders' liability may be limited by share, limited by guarantee, or unlimited liability company. What is the unlimited liability? When there is no limit on the shareholder's liability, it is called unlimited liability. Sir, how do we know whether this is limited liability or unlimited liability? I already told you, look at the company's name. The word limited is there at the end of the company's name, shareholder's liability is limited. The moment the word limited is not there, shareholder's liability is unlimited. Here only one exception, section 8 company. That is non-profit company or licensed company with permission from central government need not use the word limited. Just we have to see if the section 8 companies are there under the company's name, they use the word registered under section 8. Obviously, no confusion will be there. So, looking at a company's name, you are able to understand what is the shareholder's liability. So, we know about name clause. We know about registered office clause, we know about the liability clause. Now, fourth one is objective clause. Any company incorporated only for lawful purpose, but not for unlawful, illegal, immoral purposes. The objective of a company must be lawful. The objective may be main objective, ancillary incidental objective, and other objectives of the company. Out of all clauses, this is the very important clause to be defined. Why? There is a divorce between ownership and management in case of a company. Ownership lies in the hands of shareholders. Management lies in the hands of board of directors elected by shareholders. So, the board of directors of a company must know what purpose they have to make a plan, policy, strategies. If the board of directors of a company are working within the objective clause, we can say intra-virus. Intra means within, virus means power. Within the power, those agreements were enforceable. If they go against the objective clause, that's called ultra vires, which is nullity, which has no legal validity. So you can say objective clause is paramount important out of all the clauses. And other clause is, what is capital clause? With how much capital our company is getting incorporated? This is the maximum capital of a company at the time of incorporation. And it may be increase their capital, it may decrease their capital after its incorporation. But with how much capital getting incorporated is called your authorized capital. That's the maximum capital of a company. The authorized capital of a company is divided with nominal value of the share. In simple, authorized capital is converted into small units. Each unit is a share. Share means the interest of the shareholder of a company. Other hand, you can say a company may incorporate with both equity capital as well as preference capital. So capital clause is, well, how much capital is there at the time of incorporation. Subsequent to incorporation, if you want, you can enhance your capital. If you want, you can further reduce. Further issue is there, reduction of the capital is there, procedures can be adopted, it can do. And other one is association clause. What is association clause? The public company, minimum 7 shareholders are there. Private company, minimum 2 shareholders are there. And the OPC, 1-person company, only 1 person is there. Association clause consists of details of the subscribers of the company. With how many, minimum compulsory, and later how many shareholders who are having their name, address, proof, and the number of the shares held, amount paid, their details you have to give. That is nothing but an association clause. And last one is succession clause. As I told earlier, it is applicable only for OPC. In OPC, only one shareholder is there. If he die, who could be the next to continuation? So according to INC 3, you have to take a consent from the person. You can nominate a person as a nominee. If anything happens to original shareholder, who is the shareholder of a company, the succession clause is to be there. So in the memorandum of association, name clause, registered office clause, liability clause, objective clause, capital clause, association clause, succession clause. Succession clause applicable only to OPC, not for all. These are the contents. And according to table A, B, C, D, E, given according to schedule 1, can be adopted by a company in order to prepare your MOA. It is a charter of a company. It regulates external management of a company.
So thank you very much, sir, for such a beautiful explanation. So dear students, please make a note of the website which sir was telling you. That's www.mca, that is Ministry of Company Affairs, .gov.in. There you will find all the details with regard to how a company is incorporated, what are the documents that are supposed to be downloaded, and what are the documents that are supposed to be submitted. And as sir was saying, that this is a digitalized incorporation of a company where no documents have to be submitted. Before I ask ma'am the next question, we have got a caller online. Hello. Yeah, so ma'am, the memorandum of association is a document that establishes the relationship of the company with the outside world.
Yes.
So it contains different clauses, and we can no longer say what's in a name, because as sir was saying, there is much to a name. So in the same way, there are different clauses. These all regulate the relationship of the company with the outside world. Now a company will have certain employees within itself. It needs internal regulations and rules. Is there any other document that establishes the matters internal to the company?
Yes. Now as sir was explaining, for a company, memorandum of association is very, very important document. It is almost like a charter of the company, constitution of the company, how you relate the company with the outside world. It is the fundamentals on which the company is formed. Now, company is an artificial person, but for the day-to-day working of the company also, you need certain rules, regulations, guidelines. So, for the internal working of the company, you need to prepare a kind of a guidelines which are called as Articles of Association.
Can I just interrupt you, because we have got a caller. This we have stated is an interactive program. Hello.
Hello, sir.
Chepandi.
Sir, memu. Can I speak in English or Telugu?
Meeku edi comfortable unte dantlo maatandi. Telugu lo maatandi parlaledu. Chepandi.
Sir, madi farmer producer, Nerathalli farmer producer company undi, sir.
Okay.
2013 Act registration completed, sir.
Okay.
So, if you have other licenses, we will have to take GST and take the bylaws and government. So, we will have to take the company name and the BOD name, board of director name.
Company.
Yes, Srinivas, sir. అంటే మన కాలర్ ఒక ఫార్మర్ ప్రొడ్యూసర్ కంపెనీ కంపెనీస్ యాక్ట్ 2013
ప్రొడ్యూసర్స్ కంపెనీ ప్రాబబ్లీ
ప్రొడ్యూసర్స్
కంపెనీ సో ప్రొడ్యూసర్స్ కంపెనీ నీడ్ టు అప్లై ఫర్ జిఎస్టీ ఎగ్జంప్షన్స్ ఓన్లీ ఆన్ కంపెనీస్ నేమ్ మన ఇండివిజువల్స్ నేమ్ డైరెక్టర్స్ నేమ్ నో ఎగ్జంప్షన్స్ విల్ బి గ్రాంటెడ్ కంపెనీ ఈజ్ డిఫరెంట్ మేనేజ్మెంట్ ఈజ్ డిఫరెంట్ సో ఎనీ క్లెయిమ్ యూఆర్ మేకింగ్ అండర్ ద జిఎస్టీ ఇట్ షుడ్ బి గోస్ టు ద కంపెనీ ఓన్లీ అట్ ద ఎండ్ ఆఫ్ ద డే ద బెనిఫిట్ గో టు ప్రొడ్యూసర్స్ మెంబర్స్ ఓన్లీ Who are the members of the producers company? Farmers only or primary producers only? The benefit goes to them, sir.
Okay.
The GST benefit will be given to only company.
Yeah. So, the caller has been answered that the
Hello.
GST. Hello.
Namaskaramandi.
Chepan.
I am Krishna. My issue is regarding about Hyderabad Oil Mill Limited, which was amalgamated with Voltas.
Okay.
Hyderabad Oil Mill went under heavy losses. It has been taken over by the Voltas.
Okay.
It is a limited company.
Okay.
Public limited company.
Whether the liabilities are limited to the extent of the shares or unlimited.
Limited
by
share.
Yeah.
Limited
by
share.
Could you please tell me?
Yeah. Yes, sir. So, Srinivas, sir, the caller was saying that Alwyn Limited has been taken over by Voltas Limited, which is a public limited company. So, what is the liability of the shareholders? Is it limited or unlimited is what the caller is saying?
Any public company shareholders' liability is limited by share, which means to the extent of unpaid balance on the shares held by him. It is not a private company, no? It's a limited by
limited
share.
Company.
Capital is there. The listed company on the stock exchange. Then obviously limited by share.
Yeah. So the liability of the shareholders is limited only to the uncalled part
unpaid.
Of the capital.
Unpaid.
The unpaid part of the capital. So whatever is the uncalled or the unpaid amount, that only would be the liability of the shareholders. So it is limited liability. Now, ma'am, you were talking about the articles, I suppose.
Yes. Now, coming to the Articles of Association, though the Memorandum of Association is the most important document of the company, for internal regulation, it is important that every company prepares its Articles of Association. But there is a provision in the Companies Act itself, where you have table of articles like table F, F to actually J for different companies, it is there, table F, G, H, I, J, they are available in the Companies Act. Which can be adopted by public limited companies for the Articles of Association. Now, basically, the nature of Articles of Association is such that it is subordinate to the Memorandum of Association and Companies Act. So, articles cannot provide anything which is not there in the Memorandum of Association or Companies Act. It basically deals with the rules, regulations, laws, and the procedures by which the general or the normal course of operations in the company are to be conducted. So, it is for the day-to-day operations of the company that these rules and regulations are prepared and presented in the Articles of Association. When you are discussing about the nature of the Articles of Association, it's very important to refer
I'm
to...
I'm so sorry
yes.
that I have to interrupt you again because right. we have a caller online. Hello.
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 Yeah, I remember when was referred to BIFR for certain question really. Hello.
Okay, yes sir.
BIFR sick industry.
Yeah, the board
Hello?
For internal financial reconstruction BIFR it refers to sick industry sir and your question has been answered. You were talking about the Voltas.
Yeah. The government has taken the entire liabilities of Hyderabad Alvin Now, these are companies, limited share capital, is it applicable?
No, that is what we have told you, sir. If the liability of the company, it is a limited liability company, it will be limited to the unpaid amount of shares. So, the liability would be limited in this situation also. Ma'am, you were talking about the articles again.
Yes. You have a very important case which is always referred when you are discussing about the nature of the articles of association, which is Ashbury Railway Carriages versus Ritchie, which is a case of 1875, which very beautifully brings out the very nature of the articles of association. Firstly, it states, the articles of association is subordinate to Memorandum of Association and Companies Act.
Okay.
Secondly, they define the duties, rights, obligations and of the directors as between themselves and with the company at large. That means among themselves, among the directors and members of the company, and also with the company, because the company is a separate entity. Thirdly, it also talks about the modern form in which the business of the company is to be carried out. And lastly, how changes in the form of carrying out the business can be altered. So, it not only gives the ways in which it is to be carried out, if there is a necessity, how alterations can be done to accommodate to the changes, and how the company can modify its working, internal working, to for the smooth functioning of the company. So, what we find is, though we say that everything is paperless, it doesn't mean that you don't have to write anything. These documents have to be prepared by the company. Only thing is, you don't submit in physical form, they are uploaded into the company, I mean the required website. So, you find articles of association, if not accepted the table F, every company has to print the articles of association in a particular format. The Companies Act is very clear with this respect. It says it has to be in paragraph form, they have to be consecutively numbered, they have to be adequately stamped, and also to be signed by the signatories of the Memorandum of Association. That means all those people who have signed the Memorandum of Association should necessarily sign the Articles of Association as well. Okay. And these provisions, unless they are altered, they apply to the company for the internal working of the company, how the company is going to be managed on the day-to-day basis. Okay. So, for the internal management of the company, Articles of Association is very, very important.
Okay. So, Srinivas sir, articles of the Memorandum of Association is an important document which has to be filed. Along with this, the Articles of Association, now as ma'am was saying, seems to be the next important document. Now, once this Memorandum of Association is registered with the Register of Companies, can we again alter this memorandum? Can it be altered?
Memorandum of Association is subject to alteration anytime.
Okay.
By passing one special resolution, there are two types of resolutions are there, ordinary resolution, special resolution. Ordinary resolution requires a simple majority, 51% or more members of a company agree, resolution can be passed. A special resolution requires a 3/4 majority of the members attended and participated in the voting should agree for the proposal, resolution can be passed.
Okay.
So, here the contents of the Memorandum of Association can be altered, subject to, for example, name clause to be altered, follow the special resolution. Registered office clause to be altered, sometime ordinary resolution, sometime special resolution. And a liability clause to be altered, always a special resolution. Then capital clause to alter, ordinary resolution. Dear friends, remember, alteration of the capital clause requires only ordinary resolution, not a special resolution. And alteration of association clause, ordinary resolution. So, by passing simple resolutions, you can pass. The special resolution can be passed at general meeting or even through postal ballot. Law permits, resolutions can be passed through postal ballots also. The shareholders need not come to the company. They can send their voting through postal ballot. So, subject to conditions, Memorandum of Association contents can be altered.
Okay. Srinivas sir was telling that the memorandum can be altered.
Yeah.
In the same way, ma'am, you are talking about the articles.
Yes.
Can the articles also be altered likewise?
Yes, it can be. See, when you compare the contents of Memorandum and Articles of Association, memorandum articles are very crucial, very important for the very existence of the company, whereas the contents of articles of association are more for operational purpose. So if there is any need to change these regulations which govern the day-to-day operations of the company and which are also generally very minor issues, it can always be altered to suit the requirement. So alteration of articles of association is possible, but only thing is it should not violate the memorandum of association.
Okay.
It should not violate the Companies Act. Now say for example you have calls in arrears. That means the company has asked the shareholders to pay money on the shares. If they have not paid, we call it as calls in arrears.
Yeah.
Now company, under the Companies Act of 2013, a company can charge interest on calls in arrears to the extent of 10%. In the old act, that is 1956 act, it was only 5%. Now it is increased to 10%. That means the company can charge the shareholders 10% interest on the calls that they have not paid. Now in the articles of association, if the company says no, we want to change that, that means we want to have 12% or 13%. Now that is not allowed because the maximum they can charge is only 10%. So since it goes beyond the provision of the Companies Act, such a change will not be acceptable. Another thing is, say for example they want to make it only 8% or 6%, well it can be done because it is well within the maximum limit of 10%. So whenever a change is proposed or done in the articles of association, they have to see that it doesn't go beyond or contravene with the provisions of the memorandum of association and Companies Act. Otherwise, the members, the shareholders, the directors, as sir was saying, there are ways in which there can be alteration to the articles of association.
So likewise, does it require the special or ordinary resolution, as sir was saying, for memorandum
special resolution.
Yes. Srinivas sir, now this Companies Act 2013 arose because of, as we were saying in the beginning, because the 1956 Act had to be made more contemporary, more relevant to the existing times. So in what way is the Companies Act 1956 different from the Act of 2013? So what are the improvements made, or rather what are the changes made point wise between these two acts? So now how is 2013 different from 1956?
Before that, let me explain one simple point.
Yes sir.
In the incorporation process of a company, the steps involved in the incorporation process, let me complete first, then you see the comparative analysis between these two. If I want to start a company, first I have to decide which type of a company I would like to start. Is this private company, public company or OPC? First decide the type of a company you would like to start. Second step, in which state you want to start this company? Decide the state. Third, you have to download INC1, as already told you, that is proposing company's name. To decide the proposing company's name, download the INC1, do the needful formalities. Fourth step, minimum directors. Private company, minimum two directors. Public company, minimum three directors. OPC, one director. Remember, OPC, one director. Private company, two director. Public company, three directors. Directors identification number, DIN, you have to obtain from them. And at least one of the director, out of the total directors in our company, one director need to be person resident in India. Which means who stayed in India at least for 182 days in the preceding year. So first one, decide the type of a company. Second one, which state you want to start. Third one is proposed company's name, decide INC1. Next, minimum directors of a company. Next, memorandum of association, articles of association. These documents you have to comply. Next step is the declaration by chartered accountant, company secretary, or cost accountant, or advocate, or the promoter, first directors of a company, that for the formation, promotion, management of a company is concerned, we have complied all compliances under the Companies Act 2013. This is according to INC 8, they have to make a declaration. And the next one is INC 29, they have to download. INC 29 is affidavit. The
managerial persons, board of director, managing director, manager and promoter, plus CA, CMA, otherwise any person who is associated with formation, promotion, management of a company that for the last 5 years we were not convicted on promotion, formation, management of a company. What all informations we have submitted to ROC in the form of returns, they reflect true and fair view according to our belief fund and belief fund records. This is INC 29 is very important document. They have to give affidavit. Then first directors need to give their consent according to DIR 12. They need to give a consent accepting directorship, because no person can be a director for more than 20 companies. You need to give the consent and quote the DIN. The minimum subscribers of a company, OPC 1%, private company 2%, public company 7 members, they have to give the consent on the memorandum of association. Who is a subscriber? Who is a subscriber? Nothing but attesting the memorandum of association that we are the first members of a company. Their signature, name, number of the shares, amount paid, they have to sign. These documents they have to file with ROC. So that see to that these documents were properly complied by memorandum of association, articles of association duly signed by first subscribers. Their identity proof is compulsory. 2013 categorically mentioned their ID proof necessary, Aadhaar proof, PAN account or any address proof is necessary. It must not be a fake company getting created there. All this information filed with ROC. If ROC is satisfied, he register the name in the register meant for the registration. He will issue the certificate of registration.
Okay,
after the certificate of incorporation, company will get SIN, that is corporate identity number. This is incorporation of a company.
Yes. So, dear students, this was the lesson on incorporation of a company. We thank Dr. Swarupa Garu and Srinivas Rao sir for coming over here, sparing their time and participating in this discussion. Thank you very much.